Along with our lives, the love that we have for people sometimes change. As humans, there are many people that we love and have loved over the course of our lives. But if we were to be honest, there are some people that we loved in the past that we don't love as much today. For example, how many of you are still with the first love of your life, the first person you loved? Oh, my cousin Lisa. Yes. All right. We have a couple of people. We have a lot of married folks here. But I'm sure that not all of you are married to your first love. But you love the spouse you have with right now more than the person you loved before. Or at least I hope you do. And your spouse hopes you do. As we grow and get older, the object of our love changes. When we're born and when we're young, we love our parents the most. Our parents are the ones that provide for us, take care of us, give us food to eat, clothes to wear. When we become teenagers, probably love our friends more. We get a little bit annoyed with our parents. We still love them, but we don't want to hang out with them anymore. We want to be with our friends. Then maybe when we go to college, we love our boyfriend or we love our girlfriend the most. More than coming back home during the holidays, we want to be at the dorms with the girl or the guy we love. And as cheesy as it sounds, we'd rather be with them than our other friends. Then when we get married, we love our spouse the most. Our spouse is the world to us. They're the apple in our eye. They are number one in our hearts. When we have children, then our love goes to our children. And when we become grandparents, our love goes to our grandchildren or retirement and just hanging out. The point of all of this is to show that our love as humans is not always at the same level for each person at all times. Throughout the course of our lives, we love our parents, but as we get older and things change, they become second, third, fourth in our hearts. A couple of weeks ago, we celebrated Thanksgiving. And on Thanksgiving, I went to my aunt's house. She's sitting over there. I went to my aunt's house, and my extended family gathered together. You know, I guess I can still be considered a newlywed. I got married October 2010, so it's been just a little over a year now. And one of my other cousins got married July of this past year. So we're the two newlyweds in our family. And after dinner was over, we're all just chit-chatting, and the way our family works is after dinner, all the women go to like one side and they all talk to each other. And then all the guys gather at one side and we all talk to each other. So we're all separated into groups and we're just hanging out. And the dessert came out. We had dessert of pumpkin pie and pumpkin cheesecake, I believe. And it was brought to the men's table. Okay, I'm one of the youngest in my family, even in the cousins line. So I was in charge of cutting up the slices and making sure it gets handed out to the people. So after all the slices went out, I started eating my slice of pie, and I looked over to where the women were sitting, and I saw that my wife wasn't eating pie. So, being the good husband that I am, I went over and said, "Do you want some pie?" She said, "No, I'm okay." It's like, "Oh, all right." And then I went back to the guy's table. When we got home, my wife told me something that happened at my aunt's house during Thanksgiving, and it was regarding this pie. Apparently, before I went over to the ladies' table, my other newlywed cousin went first to that table and offered his wife pie. "Do you want some pie?" She said, "Okay," and then he left. The problem, though, is he didn't offer his mom pie. So when he left, his mom and all my aunts were saying, "Oh, look at this guy. He got married now, so he doesn't care about their mom anymore. He only wants to care about his wife." So they said, "Let's see what Charles does." Right? And just 5 minutes later, right, I went over and I offered pie to my wife. She said, "No, it's okay." And then I went back to the guy's table. So they said, "Look at Charles. He's also a pastor, but he doesn't, you know, give his mom pie." Thing is, I don't hate my mom, right? I don't hate my mom. I don't hate my parents. But being married, there's someone else that I need to take care of. And sometimes that's the person I see first. I need to take care of her. Sometimes our love as humans, we put people in ranks in our hearts. Who should be loved more? Whose love we give a little less? Someday we love a person a lot. Other days we love them a little less. But God is not like this. Our God is a God who loves us. And God's love for us never changes and never will change. Let's turn back to our scripture passage for today. It comes from Romans chapter 8, verses 35 through 39. Romans chapter 8, verses 35 through 39. This is what it says. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered to be sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Paul is asking a question here that I think we've all asked or wondered about at one point in our lives. Is there anything that can separate us from the love of God? Whether that thing is from this world, not from this world, or from our own doing. Is there anything that we can do to make God love us less? Or anything that we could do to make God love us more? The first few things listed by Paul are trouble, hardship, persecution, famine, nakedness, danger, and sword. All of these things are things that can cause us to stumble. But what Paul is saying is that even in the midst of all of this, when we're in trouble, when we're in hardship or facing persecution, don't have food or clothes, God still loves us. Even in the hardest of times, God's love for us does not cease. We may not feel it, but God's love is still there. It's unchanging, and it's unwavering. In verse 36, we get a quote that comes from Psalm 44:22, which says, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. This quote was inserted to show that persecution, hurt, suffering has always been a part of God's chosen people. Suffering is not something new for Christians today, but has been with all believers for all time. For God's sake, we face death all day long. This is what Paul is saying. And even in the midst of that, God loves us. This then tells us that God's love is there, even in suffering. Even when all the people in our Bible suffered, they all still recognized God and gave glory to God. They knew that God still loved them. And we need to know this as well. Verses 38 to 39 then talks about the things that seem not of this world. Angels and demons, present or future, any power or all of creation. It also mentions neither height nor depth can separate us from the love of God. Meaning it's impossible. It's impossible to get beyond God's loving reach. I hope when you hear this, that this is a big encouragement to you. All I can do when I read this passage is smile because of how great God's love for us is. Though we as humans have conditional love, and we love certain people sometimes and not love them at other times, God is not like this. God's love is unconditional and everlasting. Nothing in this world can make God love us less. Nothing we do can make God love us less. Even in our sin, God loved us. And because God loved us, He sent His one and only Son, Jesus Christ, to die for us and save us. Many of you guys know I worked in Korea as a pastor before I came back to the States. And I went to Korea in December of 2006 to minister there. Before I left for Korea, I met with all my family members. I said my final goodbyes and checked how they were doing. And everybody in my family at the time was very healthy, except for my maternal grandmother. At that time, my mother's mom was suffering from stomach cancer. And although for the most part she looked very well, she was losing a lot of weight. When I first got to Korea, I would call home every so often to check on how things were going, catch up with any family news, someone's getting married or someone's having a baby, anything like that. And my mother would always mention to me to remember to pray for my grandmother because she's sick, she has cancer, she's suffering, and she was getting worse and worse as the days go by. A few months later, in April of 2007, I was working at my church's preschool, and as I was teaching the students, I got a phone call, and I looked at my phone, and it came up as an international number, and it kind of was a long number, so I knew that it was a phone call from America. And my parents, they know my work schedule, so they don't usually call during times that I work. So I thought, I wonder if it's an emergency. So I gave the kids a 5-minute break. And I picked up the phone, and it was my dad. And my father said, the doctors gave your grandmother just 2 to 3 days to live, and so you need to come back home. The doctor said, since my grandmother's passing away, if there's anyone that needs to be contacted, any family members, that they need to come home and see her for one last time. So my father basically called me and told me to fly back. So I was working on the first floor of my church, and the church's pastor's office is on the third floor. So I went upstairs to tell the church of what's going on with my family and see if I could get approval to go back to the States. And apparently my father already called the church before he called me. Right, he told the church what's going on. And because of that, the church already got a plane ticket ready for me to come back to the States. So I went up and told my pastor, and he got a plane ticket to Los Angeles. My pastor told me to go, be with my family, and if I need anything, to give him a call. And also gave me an envelope, right? An envelope with some money, and told me to use it for any funeral expenses. Just give it to my parents when I get back home. So I took it, I said thank you, and I left. I think it was already like 12:30 p.m. at that time. And the flight was 4:30, right? An international flight. So I had to rush home to get packed, get dressed. And from where I live to the airport is about an hour and a half distance. So I thought, wow, I'm really pushing it. They really got me the next flight out. So I got everything packed. I was really nervous in the bus going there. And I arrived at the airport at 3:45 p.m. The flight was at 4:30. And I ran to the ticketing, and they're like, oh, why are you in a rush? Like, oh, my flight's leaving at 4:30. Like, oh, it's okay. We're not busy today. Like, oh, okay. So they told me to calm down, everything's going to be okay, and I got on the plane, and I left for America. And during the flight, the flight's about 10 to 12 hour flight, just had a lot of time to think to myself. And the first thought that came to my mind, the biggest thought that came to my mind was, for the first time in my life, I had to be a pastor to my family. Before this, I was an intern at a church, and I was a pastor in Korea for roughly 4 months, and all of a sudden I had to be a pastor to my family during a time when someone's going to pass away. And I was very worried. What was I going to say? What can I do to lift up the spirits of my family? I arrived at LAX, and my brother picked me up from the airport, and we headed to UC Irvine Medical Center. That's where my grandmother was. When we arrived and walked towards her room, I was expecting the worst. The doctor said 2 to 3 days, she has left, and I was already on like a 12-hour flight, so more time has passed by. So I was expecting the worst. I'd been to funerals before, so I've seen a dead person, but I've never seen a person dying. I've never seen a person dying, so I was just kind of a little bit nervous. You know, I was just expecting someone on their deathbed, not moving much, not saying much. But when I walked into my grandmother's room, I saw her sitting on her bed. She looked up at me and said, "Hi, Pastor, what are you doing here?" And I was very shocked, right? She was supposed to be someone that was going to be passing away in just a few days. But she was joking around. She was energetic. She was smiling. And I thought, did the doctors get this wrong? Then in the back of my mind, a second thought came. The church gave me money to give to my parents when my grandmother passes away. What if she doesn't pass away? Because she looks like she wouldn't. Do I take the money and return it to the church? What if she passes away after I go back to Korea, like a day or two or a week or two later? Do I get the money back from church and then come back to the States once again? All right. Regardless of anything, I was just glad that my grandmother was okay. And I asked my mom what happened, and she told me that my grandmother got a little better and that she may also be able to leave the hospital in a couple of days. So that day, I spent it at the hospital just talking with my grandmother, telling her about Korea. You know, after my grandmother left Korea in the 90s, she never went back. So a lot of things changed. So I told her how many things have changed. Even the Korean currency changed. So I gave her the new Korean bills, and she put it in her Bible so they won't get folded. After that, I went home, went to bed. The next day, I went back to the hospital and spent more time with my grandmother. After a while, I think my grandmother was getting very burdensome, right? She's like, "Just go. You know, I don't want you to be here anymore." So I was like, "Okay." So me and my brother, we just ended up staying there for like 3 hours, and we just went home. But when I went back the third day, things were very different. I went in. My mom was already there, and my grandmother's eyes were glossed over. She was not moving. Her mouth was agape. And the doctor told us that her time has come. My grandmother at the time was not hooked up to a heart monitor. So I asked the doctor, "How would I know if she passed away?" And the doctor said, "If you feel her feet and they're extremely cold, then the blood stops circulating in her body, and that means she passed away." Now I had to be a pastor to my family. What was I going to do? My brother and my father, they were at work, and when my mother called them, they were stuck in traffic trying to get to the hospital. And so my mother, she started singing my grandmother's favorite hymn in Korean. So I got a Korean Bible, and I opened up to here, Romans chapter 8, a chapter that's always been very encouraging to me. And I slowly began reading Romans chapter 8 to my grandmother in Korean. I stumbled through it, you know, flubbed some words. But all the while, it seemed like my grandmother was paying attention, that she was listening and understanding. Then I read these final few lines, saying that nothing can separate us from the love of God. I finished reading and said amen, and then my grandmother said amen. And I said, "Grandma, do you believe everything that I said?" And she nodded slightly. But while I was reading the Bible, I noticed that my grandmother was looking out the window. And to look out the window was behind where I was standing. So she had to really arc her back and get in a kind of a uncomfortable position to look out the window. So I asked her, "Grandma, what are you looking at? What do you see?" And my grandmother said, "I see Jesus." So I told her, "If Jesus comes and he reaches out his hand to you, then take it and never let it go, and go where he leads." And then my grandmother passed away just a few minutes after that. I don't know if my grandmother really saw Jesus that day. I looked out the same window and all I saw was the sky and clouds. But I believe that she did. I believe that Jesus was there with her in her pain, in her suffering, and in her death. Our passage today says, even life and death cannot separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. And this experience affirmed to me that this is true. That even in my grandmother's passing, God loved her very much. God loves all of us in here. God loves all of us unconditionally. So then what? What are we to do with this knowledge? This is what it says in 1 John chapter 4, verses 9 through 11. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. Amen. How did God show his love for us? By sending his Son into the world that we may live through him. What is love? Not that we loved God, but God loved us so much that he sent his Son to atone for our sins. Then what is our response? What are we to do? Because God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. We need to love one another. The Bible tells it to us very simply. God loves you, so love those around you. How many of you in here can say that you love your brothers and sisters? How many of you can say that you love God's creation? Some of us in here, we have people that we straight up hate. There are people in the world, maybe even in this room, that we just cannot stand. Is this the right attitude to have? We, from our sin, love each other conditionally. I like you when you're good to me, but when you piss me off, I'm never going to talk to you again. God's love is unconditional. And every day we're told to strive to be more like God. That we need to try and love each other unconditionally. No matter how crazy, no matter how hard that sounds. I know that's a tall order. Something really tough to do. But think about why you don't like a certain person. Or what makes it hard for you to love someone else. Are those things that we really should be caring about? And greatly affect us, that it hinders us from caring about others and loving them. After my grandmother died, she was cremated. And I asked my mother, why was she cremated? Because I knew that my grandmother had a burial plot at Rose Hills. My grandmother had bought three burial plots, one for herself, one for my father, and one for my mother. And so if she had these burial plots, why didn't she just get buried? Why did she get cremated? And this is what my mother told me. In 2002, I had an uncle on my father's side who passed away very suddenly. He was still of a relatively young age, but he had a heart attack. And unfortunately, there was no one around. So there was nobody there to call for help. So because there was no one to call for the ambulance, though he could have survived, he passed away. This uncle and his family, they weren't the richest in our extended family group. They were living, you know, month to month, day by day. And from this event, my grandmother, she developed a huge regret. She told my mother that she regretted not giving this family a burial plot. They were not very rich, struggling financially, and had a hard time getting a funeral ready at the very last minute. And my grandmother felt, you know, she could have helped out if she just gave up one of those plots to the family. But she didn't. So for all the years afterwards, this was just a big thing that was in her heart that she regretted. So before she passed away, she told my mother to cremate her so that if another tragedy happens to anybody that she knows who may not have that much money, to just give this extra plot to that person and lift a financial burden from them. When I heard this, I was so moved. Even when my grandmother was passing away, she had this love to try and help out perhaps a total stranger by lifting a burden from their shoulders. This showed me the love that we should have for others. In 1 John, the author does not say, love those who are easy to love. Love your friends and family. Love your fellow church members. But he writes, love others. This encompasses everyone in the world. Are you loving those around you? Are you loving your family, your friends, your fellow church members, your fellow classmates? Are you loving your fellow coworkers, the guy who takes your order at the restaurant, the person who bags your groceries for you? Are you loving them? If not, what is stopping you from loving them? We can show our love for others by caring for them, praying for them, helping them, becoming a bit uncomfortable so that others can be comfortable. God loves us, and we also ought to love one another. As Paul writes in the book of Romans, nothing can separate us from the love of God. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. In a time when we're struggling financially, when the weather is getting colder and people are getting sick, in a time when we feel alone and face an ever-changing world, I hope that you know that God loves you. God's love remains for you, even in the hardest of times. Though the world changes, the things around us changes, and circumstances changes, one thing that never changes is God's love for you. If it seems that you have not felt God's love in a long time, draw near to Him. Feel it once again. Feel that warmth once again. Can you be like Paul and say, I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate me from the love of God that's in Christ Jesus our Lord? Can you confidently say this and know this in your heart? I hope that you do. I hope that when you realize this, all you do is smile. Because this fact, this knowledge of knowing that the God who created the world, that God loves you, that should bring a smile to your face and a tear to your eye. And with this knowledge, I hope you love one another. Though it may be hard to love people at times, can you put differences aside? Strive to be more like God and love them with that same heart. In a world where things can change in a day, and people's feelings for you can change in a day, know that God's love for you never changes. And there's nothing, nothing that can separate us from the love of God. Let's pray. Now, as we have this close our time of worship together, I want us to just think about all the things that God has done in our life. God chose you out of millions and millions of people to be His child. What an honor. What an honor it is to be called a child of God. During this time where we spend a minute or two just conversing with God, I want you guys to thank God for the love He bestows upon you. And maybe even ask for forgiveness that we turned away from Him. And also pray that even though it's hard, that you could, He will give you the strength to love those around you. Let's take a minute to just thanking God for His love.